Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I just wanted to make a short video tonight. You know, I had several kind of back orders on the prayer oil, the anointing oil, and books. Brother Sid, I thank the Lord that Brother Sid was able to send out about 30 for me while I was gone. And praise the Lord, and I have a backlog just the last couple of weeks, and was able to send, I got them all packed up to go out. So if you've made a love gift for some of the prayer oil or the book or both, I'll be sending them out tomorrow. By the grace of God, I'll get to the post office. I got them all packed up. Anyway, so the Lord led me to look at something in this book, brothers and sisters. And it's the final charge. The Lord gave me a word for the church. And then, you know, I didn't even think about it, really. I didn't connect it, you know, because that's how I do, brothers and sisters. I focus on hearing from the Lord and saying what the Lord wants me to say instead of, like, the meaning of it sometimes. Exactly, you know, the ramifications of it is a, the big word. Anyway, so the title of the book is Final Boarding Call, Satan's Plan for the Ages and Our Last Mission. And so the final boarding call for what? For the rapture, Satan's plan for the ages. Well, you know, the Lord had given me the names of the chapters. Satan's master plan, Satan's sages, Satan's worship leaders, Satan's devices, Satan's seductions, and Satan's seeds. Now, you know, I don't really care about what the devil's doing. Lots of times we say that. But brothers and sisters, I wrote right in this book in 2013, that the creation is really like a big chess game, and the devil's trying to get as many pieces of the Lord's chess game that he can, and then the Lord is, of course, is going to win. We know that, but the way the Lord told me to look at it was like a chess game. You know, the black pieces, the Satan's pieces versus God's pieces, the white pieces, the holy pieces, and Brother Gary and I, Brother Bear 049, we both had he'd had a dream and I had a vision at the exact same time a year or so ago about this being part of the chess team, being on the chess team of the Lord. And, you know, so the book that the Lord gave me, and I just want to say this, Brother Gary and I have talked about it on and off over the last year or so, or 6 months or a year, and prayed about it, say a good 6 months or maybe. And, you know, he was telling me that he had a dream from the Lord that I already know the answers. You know, what to do and what the answers are from the Lord. And I didn't even, you know, I've been praying, well, you know, exactly, you know. There's lots of things the Lord has shown me. What does that mean? But, brothers and sisters, tonight the Lord was just telling me. And I've had this book, you know, for a year and a half. And tonight the Lord is telling me that's what I put, the Satan's plan for the ages, that's the strategy that the Lord gave me because he wants us to overcome it. So it's our last mission, our last mission. So in the book, I gave a lot of these details and stuff and all this about Aleister Crowley and about how the, you know, the women's liberation movement, the homosexual movement, all these things are rooted in the past and from Satan to destroy the United States and destroy the Christian civilization and bring about the new world order. But the Lord gave me a final charge at the end of this book, brothers and sisters, and I want to read it to you. This is what the Lord wants us to do. A lot of you guys who listen to me, you want to be raptured, right? You know, Jesus said this gospel of the kingdom will be preached to the whole world, and then the end shall come. So we have a part to play, brothers and sisters, and that is to win the last sheep to come into the kingdom, and then boom, we're out of here. So, and lots of you have been, as an example, praying for Joshua's ministry, praying for me to do the ministry of the Lord. Praise God. Those who have donated for the orphanages and the feeding programs and some, and a few people have even donated for my travels back and forth to the Philippines and to go do, meet with people like in Dallas and things like that. Praise God for that, brothers and sisters. I thank the Lord for everything that God has provided, and he does it through us. You know, he uses men and women to do his work. He uses his people. You know, the Lord doesn't come down and preach the gospel to people. He uses people. He uses people to pray. He uses people to donate. All the above. So praise God for that. But I just want to read this to you. The last page of the book. And this is really what we got to do. Let me read this to you. Psalm 68:1, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Let them also that hate him flee before him. May we, the church, be filled with the love of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit so that we might abound in good works for the sake of the gospel, not for salvation. Lots of times I make videos of people who are trying to be saved by works. That's what I'm dealing with, this false gospel that's on, you know, particularly on YouTube. This video is on YouTube. People giving a gospel, an accursed gospel, a different gospel of works. But when we're saved, it says right there in Ephesians chapter 2, we are not by grace are you saved through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. By grace are you saved through faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. And then it goes on to say we're not saved by works, but we are saved unto do good works. The Lord saves us, and then he's predestined us because he foreknew, the Bible says, that we would say yes to him. He foreknew that I would go to the Philippines, so he predestined that I would do the orphanages there because he foreknew what I was going to do. He foreknew you that you would say yes to him. He foreknew that people would say no to him. No matter what, they would never get saved. You know, and I believe God when he said in Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purposes. So in other words, there are people who live their life and would go to hell, save for the fact that they got cancer. So there's people that get cancer, and only because they had cancer, God foreknew that if they got cancer, they would get saved. Now, God doesn't always heal them. So people say, well, so-and-so, he got cancer and he died. Yeah, but before he died, he got saved. I have a cousin. It's my dad's first cousin, but he's only a few years older than me. He had a brain tumor. And he was like a hardcore Harley Davidson motorcycle rider and all this kind of stuff. And into that culture and lifestyle was as far from being a Christian as you could be. He got a brain tumor and he started going to church. But he didn't get saved and he got sick and he was almost at the point of death. And he finally prayed and said, you know, God, if you give me one more chance, I want to go back to church and get saved and get baptized. And he got better. I mean, he got completely better. I mean, almost 100% symptomatic free. Now, brain tumor is pretty rough. You know, you can't even walk and all kinds of stuff, you know. You name it. It's horrible. And sometimes in his situation, but he was almost completely healed. He went back to church for about 6 months. He was in great shape. He got saved. He got baptized and all these things. And then it came back and he died. He was only like about 50 years old, 49 or 50 maybe. But, you know, praise God, if he had not got that brain tumor, as far, you know, who knows, but as far as we know, he couldn't have been any farther from being a Christian until he got that brain tumor. So that's how God works, brothers and sisters. He loves us so much, as the Bible says, he demonstrated his love for us, God has demonstrated his love for us while we were yet sinners. He died for us. I mean, that's pretty awesome. You know, as the saying is, while he was on the cross, you were on his mind, you know. And that is awesome. That's true. He only got on the cross and laid down his life for us, the sheep. As he tells us in John chapter 10, you know, I'm the good shepherd. No man takes my life, but I lay it down. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it back up again. And if I be, you know, lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Now listen to this charge that the Lord gave me, brothers and sisters. I want to close this book with a word from the Lord, a final charge given to me as I was writing this chapter. Be fruitful and multiply. Replenish the church with my love. We should have capitalized that C, I guess. Replenish the church with my love. I will infuse you with my love. My love is a consuming fire. The last verse of Hebrews chapter 12 or 13. My love is furiously stirred for the lost. Tell the people I am, capital I am, a title of God. I am the bread of life. I am the, you know, the manna that came down from heaven. I am the good shepherd. I am that I am, as God told Moses from the burning bush. Jesus proclaimed himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the bread of life. All these things. Tell the people I am calling. and God is calling, come home. The wedding banquet is ready. Now listen to me, brothers and sisters. I want the rapture to happen just as bad as all of you, and it's going to happen soon. And the Lord's call to the lost, those who are not ready for the rapture, is come home. The wedding banquet is ready. Brothers and sisters, you know, my mission on YouTube is this. I've been trying to tell you guys this in so many ways. You know, I've had to, because God gave me the authority and the anointing and the power to deal with all these Judaizers and false gospel people and greasy gracers, as I call them, people that believe you can say the sinner's prayer when you're 8 years old, live like the devil all your life and go to heaven. These extreme ideas that are outside the scope and the authority of the Word of God. Listen, brothers and sisters, this is what the Lord is calling us to do. Listen. We want the rapture to happen, of course, and it's going to happen any moment, any day. But until that moment, this is what the Lord is commanding us to do. Of course, He says it, you know, it's not just what I wrote. It's a different way of saying what He already said. You know, go to all the nations, making disciples of the nations. Making disciples. You know, listen to what it says. Be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful in making new Christians. Multiply new Christians. Replenish the church with my love. See, the church, as the Lord is just, you know, prompting me what He's talking about. When Jesus tells about the end times in Matthew chapter 24, He says the love of many would wax cold. You know, waxing and waning is like the moon. The moon is waxing and it's waning and all that. So the love of many would wax cold. So it would grow, waxing is to grow, in coldness. To wane is, you know, to go less. So people's love is waxing cold, many, Jesus said. That's the problem. That's why they don't care about the lost. Of course we want to be raptured. Of course we want to separate ourselves from the world. But Jesus said in His words, you know, what shepherd, He's the good shepherd. What shepherd have 99 sheep, 100 sheep, one is lost, He doesn't leave the 99 and go get the one. And then when He finds the one, He rejoices with His friends that He found the one. It's like the widow with her coins. She has lots of gold coins. She loses one gold coin. And then when she finds it, she calls her friends and has a celebration. Hey, I found my gold coin. But those other coins were never gone. The story of the prodigal son. His other son never went away. Just his younger brother went off. But the father celebrated because his son who was lost has now been found. That's God. Over and over again, the Lord is telling us this. And when I listen to people's comments and all these people debating all of these secondary, non-essential doctrines, even the rapture, you do not have to believe in the rapture to be saved. And if you do or do not believe in the rapture, it does not affect your salvation, brothers and sisters. It may affect the crown that you would get for those who love His appearing. The Bible says, you know, Jesus said, don't let anybody steal your crown. And the Apostle Paul says that there's a crown of righteousness for those who love His appearing. And I believe that's clearly referring to the rapture. So there's a crown for that, but crowns and rewards in heaven is not the same as getting there, right? We all just want to get there. Crowns and those things are secondary to us getting there. So brothers and sisters, we need to focus on having the love, as Jesus said, or, you know, through the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, even though I can speak with the tongues of men and angels, without love, I am nothing. I'm just a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And he talks about how, you know, if you play an instrument like a trumpet and you're not making any tune and you're just garbled up the sounds, how does that benefit anybody if it doesn't have a tune? He's not only talking about having an interpretation for the gift of tongues done in the public, in the church setting, in front of the whole church. You need to have an interpreter. But he's also referring, you know, walking in the rhythm and the beat of the love of God. You know, you're just beating your, walking to your own drum. And that's where there's a positive and a negative side to that on YouTube. Lots of people are on YouTube, including myself, who are disillusioned with organized religion. Organized religion never saved anybody. But God is also not a God of anarchy. I've talked about this many times, brothers and sisters. It says God, all things work together for those who good who love Him are called according to His purposes. And the Lord talks about, there in 1 Corinthians, about the gifts. You know, how somebody has a gift of tongues and then someone else has a gift of healing. And then Paul is saying, you know, the hand can't say to the eye or the nose, I don't need you. You know, the ear, I don't need you. You know, each part of the body of Christ has a different role to play. Some are evangelists. Some are missionaries. Some are pastors. Some are prayer warriors. Some are rich business people that donate to buy Bibles and give away in the Philippines or build orphanages in the Philippines or, you know, to... do some whatever, a youth concert, a Christian youth concert, evangelism, you know, here in the States or whatever. Whatever. God would call us to our different callings in the body of Christ. But we all have to do it all in love. So listen, replenish my church with my love. The love of many is wax cold. They don't love God and they don't love the law. So that's the problem with these people. They hate Israel. They hate everybody. Lots of these denominations. The love is wax cold. Replenish the church with my love. I will infuse you with my love. God wants to fill us with his love. He's going to fill us with his love if we submit and allow him. You got to submit to the Lord. That's what you need to do. God will give you the love for the lost. He'll give you that, you know, we call it a pastor's heart in the ministry. God will give you that shepherd's heart, that pastor's heart, to have love to shepherd people, to disciple people, even if it's just one person, several people, or thousands. My love is a consuming fire. God's love will burn you up. Step into the fire of his love. Get into the burning bush. You know, it'll burn you up. My love is furiously stirred for the lost. Did you hear that? My love is furiously stirred for the lost. Tell the people I am calling. Come home. The banquet, the wedding banquet is ready. We need to tell the lost people, all these people saying, well, you know, I hear it every day. You know, when I say something to the end times about people, they look at me like I'm crazy. Don't worry about it. You tell them, look, the marriage supper of the Lamb is ready and the Lord is compelling people to come in. That's what he said in the parable there in near the end of Matthew, about chapter 22 or 23. The Lord said, you know, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in. Tell them, hey, the king is having a free banquet, no charge to get in. Come on in. You know, tell them that we're living in the end times. Then you can share, you know, the gospel that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whomsoever should believe it in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That they need to repent of their sins and call all who call upon the name of the Lord would be saved. Romans 10:17, you know, Romans 10:9. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. You know, they got to believe it in their heart. That's the difference between just saying a sinner's prayer and repentance and confession and humility. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. You know, they need to, and I agree with the way of the master technique. You can go look that up of Kirk Cameron and Ray Comfort from Australia. You know, people need to don't. It's not even a fact of getting them to do a sinner's prayer. Let them speak from their own heart. Ask them to start talking to the Lord. Just listen. See how they say, you know, or give them some ideas. They don't need to repeat what you say. You know, that's the problem with most of the churches, too. They do this sinner's prayer. Let people speak from their heart. If they understood the gospel and they're mentally capable, they're not mentally handicapped, you know, or a little child, when you tell them, you know, the gospel, and you've told them the gospel clearly, then they will know what to say. You know, if they need any help, just guide them a little bit. You know, talk to Jesus like I'm talking to you. You know, confess to the Lord, hey, Jesus, I'm lost. They need to know, not just repeat, but know. Confess with their mouth and believe in their heart. They got to know they are lost. No one can be saved until they know they're lost. They need to be under conviction of sin. That's why, like I said, go look at the way of the master. They need to be under conviction of sin. Let me just say this because I'm already almost at 20 minutes. If I come up to a guy on the street and I say, hey, dude, Jesus Christ is coming back soon, man. Have you seen the stuff going on TV and ISIS and the Middle East and all these things going on? And start talking to them about it and say, man, you know, this the Bible talked about this stuff. You know, the NSA tracking people, they can put a chip in people, 666. You know, and the guy says, yeah, I know. Yeah, I heard about that when I was a kid. Yeah, that stuff's true. I believe it. Yeah, we're coming to the end of time, man. Something's going to go down, nuclear war and all this. Then you just ask them, well, are you saved? If you die today, do you know where you're going or not? Now, if they tell you, I'm going to hell, and you say, why do you say you're going to hell? Because I know I've been bad. I know I haven't been good. I know I'm a sinner, and I've been, you know, living with a girl I'm not married to. I've been partying and drinking and smoking dope and all this, whatever they say. That person doesn't need to be brought under conviction. They're already under conviction. They already told you they're going to hell. They know it. That person needs to hear grace. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So when you hear out of their mouth, because Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You can tell what's in somebody's heart if you just be quiet and listen. Be quiet and listen. People talk about, I have discernment. Yeah, there is discernment sometimes when people are lying. But if people are speaking truthfully, they're saying right out of their heart what they believe. So the guy says, yeah, I believe Jesus is the Christ, but, you know, I believe Jesus and all that stuff, but, you know, I've been partying and living large, and, you know, and I'm just not ready to, you know, to change my life and live for Christ. That person, you know, like I said, if they say they know they're going to hell and they're humble themselves, then you give them the grace, you give them the gospel. You know, Jesus died for you. Today is the day of salvation. Don't wait till tomorrow, man. You don't know what might happen to you tomorrow. There could be an earthquake. You could be in a car wreck. You never know. You know, the Lord, you know, might not send somebody to you. You know, I came to you today out of the blue. This is your appointed time from God. Today, let's commit to God today. And if they want to, don't just say a sinner's prayer to get rid of you. That's where you have to have, you know, that spiritual discernment. You know, if they're being sincere and being honest, man, and I believe that almost, basically, generally speaking, people should be crying. They should be in tears, not laughing and joking and clowning around. If they're convicted, they will be upset. They will be worried that, hey, if I wait another, you know, I don't want to wait another minute because I could die right now. God could strike me dead. They have that fear of God and the wrath of God. They've got that revelation in their mind, in their heart, that they're in big trouble with God, and they need to want to make it right now. They can't wait another minute to make it right. That person is ready to get saved. But if you talk to people and they say, well, you know, I believe I'm a good person, and if you ask them, are you going to heaven? Yes. Why? Oh, I'm a good person, blah, blah, blah. They start giving you all that arrogance and pride. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. That's when you give them the Ten Commandments. That's when you bring that spirit of conviction. God gave us his word. That's what the law is all for, brothers and sisters, to bring that sin consciousness to the lost to start with. And the word will accomplish. God says in his word, I cast my bread upon the water, you know, and it will not return unto me void. God's word will accomplish what he pleases, he says. So that's when you begin to tell them that, you know, like I said, if you can check out the videos of the Way of the Master, you would say something like, well, if you died and you're going to go to heaven, will God judge you by your standard or his? You know, why do you call yourself good? Let's see what God says makes a good person. Have you ever committed adultery? They say, oh, no. Well, no, I've never committed adultery, or I'm not married. Okay. Have you ever looked on a woman with lust? Yes. Okay. Jesus said, if you look on a woman with lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. Have you ever taken anything that doesn't belong to you? That's called stealing. Thou shalt not steal. Have you ever been mad at somebody enough to kill them? Jesus said, if you angry with your brother without a cause, you've committed murder in your heart. You know? So, have you ever told a lie? Yes. What do you call that? A liar. What do you call someone that tells lies? A liar. So, you're a liar, an adulterer at heart, a thief at heart. And the New Testament says that all liars have their place in the lake of fire. That's what it says in the New Testament. So, you're a lying adulterer, a thief at heart. If God judges you by his standard, will you go to heaven or hell? See, that's when the Word of God accomplishes God's plan. The Holy Spirit brings conviction. That's what you just gave them, the information, the Word of God. And then it's up to God, the Holy Spirit, to bring conviction on their heart. Then once they fall under conviction and they say, yeah, you're right. I guess I'm not a good person. I guess if I died today, I'd go to hell. Now the Spirit of God is working in the heart. Now they're ready for grace. The Lord wants you to tell people that he's coming soon, that the banquet is ready. Time's up. Party's over. Time to get right with God. Time to get off the fence. Tell them that the Lord wants them to get off the fence. They need to choose. They don't have to keep doing all this clowning around, messing around and trying to play games with God. Brothers and sisters, you know that I love you. I'm giving you a little bit of teaching here. As the Lord leads me, I don't know if I've talked about this stuff in the past or not. I can't remember. You know, I always have some regular viewers, and then there's always new viewers. So praise God. I know that this word will go and accomplish what God pleases and what he wills. I love you guys. I will see the brothers and sisters in Nashville, like Brother Todd. Used to be Revelation 311. He's got a different channel name. I think it's Humble Servant. Excuse me. See Brother Todd, Sister Linda Kirby, several others. There's a Brother Charles. I don't think he makes videos. Several other brothers and sisters who I was supposed to see in Nashville. I will be there. the weekend I will be seeing people on the 13th. On the 13th of June, Saturday, June the 13th in Nashville. After that, I'm not sure if I will continue or come back here and then go out another time. I may end up flying somewhere like Dallas. Not sure. I'm going to go to Chicago. The Lord has already spoken to me. I've got to go to Seattle, Portland, and Vancouver one time, in Chicago, and by the grace of God, in Dallas, again, in Houston, and even in the Northeast, brothers and sisters. I wait to hear back from the Lord of that. And then in Florida, too. Now is the time. And then I'll be out there in L.A., Bakersfield, Las Vegas. The Lord has, told me to go and do and work hard and labor fast because the time is so short. So I will be pushing through, brothers and sisters, as God enables me with this grace and the strength and the wisdom and the provisions and everything to go do all that He wants me to do, brothers and sisters, to finish the race. And I ask for your prayers, brothers and sisters, to do that. I'm praying for all of you who have asked me for prayers. I'm going to be working on the words of wisdom and words of knowledge. I have not forgot. Praise God, the Lord told me He wants me to do it. I will do it. If I have time, I will do it tomorrow. Love you guys. And I thank the Lord. My internet was so slow in the Philippines, and now my internet's so fast. It's just so awesome, to be able to load a video. It usually takes me like 3 or 4 hours to load a 15-minute video in the Philippines. It's crazy. I love you guys. God bless you all. And just message me for your prayers, prayer requests, and all those things. I'm here for you guys as much as I can be. And the only people that I don't, there are sometimes people who are playing games and stuff. And after I discern that, I have to stop, letting them take up all my time. But it's, 1 out of 100 that's like that, brothers and sisters. I praise the Lord that 99% of the people I dealt with are dear brothers and sisters in the Lord. And I'm not going to never let that 1% or maybe 2%, whatever it is, knock me off serving God. We always have the thorn in the flesh. And all of you guys know what I'm talking about. You have those thorns in the flesh. Those things that'll just be annoying. Like I got a piece of tape on my finger from packing those packages, a little piece of tape, I can't get rid of it. It's like that, just a little bit of a thorn in the flesh and annoyances. I love you guys. God bless. Aloha.